Okay. So. What I want to do is to close the cycle. We said our cycle is two adiabats, two isochores, and now we want to optimize it. So we have two choices. Let's take the first choice that we say that we use frictionless solutions to the adiabats. And as I said, we'll look for mu the fastest as possible, so it should be a little bit smaller than that. So we can find a solution or a timing, if you want, which would the time will determine mu in such a way that our adiabats are perfect. They are finite time and they're perfect. So what we have to optimize, if this is our cycle, like that, this is TH. This would be TC. So we have to optimize on the thermalization. In a way, this is all what's left now to do, which is an easier test. So what did we see? Our efficiency didn't change. Our efficiency didn't change. Just to remind us, W is delta omega times delta n, and QH is omega H against time delta. So our omegas are fixed. We can change that. This is a compression ratio of the engine. I buy an engine. That's it. That's what my dealer gives me. So, but I can change this stuff, the amount of thermalization that I get. So, you could say the maximum thermalization, if delta N is bigger, I'll get more work. That's for sure. The efficiency won't change. I'll get more work. On the other hand, I'm not interested really in work. I'm interested in power. And power is W divided by tau cycle. Okay, so what is the time tau cycle? We have the time on the hot isochore plus the adiabat . So this is the time allocation. So in a way, we already set these. These are set. We can't touch them. So what we can optimize are these times. Now these times will determine how much thermalization we allow our engine to have. So as we said, we can allow a lot of thermalization, a little bit of thermalization. So we can optimize with respect to these two parameters of thermalization, and that will determine delta N. Delta omega, in a way, is set. So, if we look at this exercise, in a way, this is exponential, and also exponential here. We can ask how much the time. I'll write the expression. It's not too difficult to derive. That this W here becomes two terms. It has h bar omega h minus omega c, which is constant. Then another term, which is the equilibrium of the hot the equilibrium of the code. So you can see this puts the limit. This is delta omega, and this is the maximum we can get delta n. The difference between the equilibrium value of the hot and cold. And now we are going to reduce that because we want to pay in time. So we'll multiply this by the cost. How much time does it take? And this is, we can write it as an exponent like that. Xc minus 1. And where xch is just define it, it's just the rate times time. So let's write it. Xc is the rate of on the cold side times the time allocation. So the reason to write it like that, it's easier to optimize with respect to x than with respect to c, because you can see the time goes with the rate together. So why should you optimize it separately? So this is the expression to optimize. So you can see it has two parts. This part is constant. It's independent, and only this part depends on time. From this immediate, you see this is delta omega times delta n equilibrium. This always appears, which means also that our efficiency won't change. So we can write this as a function, some g, which is a function of omega, GW, which is a function of the parameters that we have here, times another function f, which is this piece here. So now we just have to optimize with...
I understand the exponentials in the numerator, but I don't understand the denominator.
We're here?
Yeah.
This?
The denominator.
Here?
Yeah, why is it?
Xc plus xh?
Yeah, why is it?
This is just algebra. You do it separately for here and here, and then you combine the terms and you get them.
You assume that I still tell mistakes?
No, you don't. Okay. We don't have to assume anything. You just look at the equation motion of thermalization of n. This is all what I need. Yeah. And I can assume it's thermal because we said if it's frictionless, I can be on the energy scale of it. So what you do, you write the change in delta n here, and you change, write it here, and then you combine. So it's some lines of algebra that you get this expression. Okay, so now, if we have this expression, we have two pieces. We have this piece and this piece. So then we can say, okay, let's try to go to the engineers and say, let's get the maximum efficiency out of it. So as we said, the efficiency doesn't depend on the timing. So, but what can we play with? What are the parameters we can play for efficiency? We can play with a compression ratio. We can change the ratio between omega C and omega H. So, from the point of view of efficiency, we can look just at this term here, and we can say, okay, what is the best choice of the given temperatures of the hot side, the cold side, which you could say the hot side is dependent on the temperature in your engine, the cold side, the cooling fluid. What is the best compression ratio of my engine to get maximum efficiency at maximum? So we'll optimize W to optimize the work, and then we'll get efficiency at maximum power. So you see here what we get here is difference in temperatures. So it's easier to go to high temperature limit. So I have this expression, I'll call it G work, which is, you see, delta omega times delta N equilibrium. And I want to optimize it with respect to the compression ratio. And I just want to be sure how I'm writing the compression ratio like that. Omega H divided by omega C. Usually for your car, it's around 8. For a diesel engine, it's higher. Maybe 9. If it's my Lamborghini, it's 12. But higher compression ratio. So I want to optimize this expression with respect to the compression ratio. And for this, I'll go to a high temperature limit, and then I can write this as KTC 1 minus the compression ratio plus KTH 1 minus the compression ratio minus 1. And this is this GW. Okay, so now my optimization is with respect to C, my compression ratio. So this is something that we can do, just take the derivative and look for the maximum. And what we see that for this we get at C, the best is TH divided by TC. Which means that the auto efficiency, which is 1 minus omega C divided by omega H, is 1 minus the square root of TC divided by TH. So I brought this just to show you that this engine, you can say the efficiency at maximum power will be at the high temperature limit, will give us this result of what we call Coulson-Albon or Novikov. It's less than Carnot, but for this auto engine, you can see this is the best efficiency we can do. And remember, this is under adiabatic conditions. It's not adiabatic, we could say shortcut to adiabaticity. And in a way, this is irrespective of how we optimize or how much time allocation we do this. Okay, this is a little bit nasty equation to solve, but again, this can be done and you can get the efficiency. So if you want, I'll just write the final result for the efficiency, or the time, tau h is approximately tau c. Let's say the heat conductivity is the same, and this becomes 1 over the rate, gamma, which has to be here and here. And the total time is 2 times this time. This is what we would get. Okay, so I did this to show you that this, our simple model can be solved, and we get a result that we like, or at least at some limit it gives us something that we saw at other places that always gives satisfaction, as I said. And We'll treat the auto engine in different scenarios, but before we go, we'll do that, I want to give some general theory about generalized Gibbs states, which I talked about before, but I'll try to say what it means. So this is just to complete the picture I started. So as I said, the density operator in equilibrium, the canonical state, we can write it like that, e to the power of beta h, where beta is inverse temperature, and we can say this is maximum entropy subject to what we know about the system. We know only the energy. Now, if we know other operators, which we can write their expectation values like that, we can say, we can write a generalized Gibbs state, which we could write it like that, which would be, again, maximum entry subject to these expectation values. And if you want, I put this normalization, I can put here the identity, so the normalization will also be included in this set of operators. So this is, you can do that, and many times this is possible, but if these operators don't commute, this becomes quite different. So then we need something. And what we need is an idea that is called canonical invariance. And we discussed it while we went here a little bit implicitly. Now I want to say what it means explicitly. For example, we know if we are adiabatic, we're in a thermal state throughout the cycle. The temperature changes in time, but the state itself, we can describe it in a canonical form. That's why it's called a canonical invariance. So we can have a description of our state with respect to one variable, in this case, energy. So this we can do in the adiabatic limit. One variable is enough. But now we want to do this in general, not only with one variable, the temperature. We want to do it in many, and the question is, here's our equation of motion. Can our canonical form stay canonical or generalized canonical throughout the cycle? So this is a paper that studied this in master equations, and which you could say goes to Irvine Oppenheim. This is a different Oppenheim than we know now today in quantum thermodynamics. He was the editor of Fizdrev E, the first editor of Fizdrev E. And you can see this paper is 1964. Here's what I'm going to use. This paper from 1977, work of El-Hasid and Levine. And you can say we used it in this paper. So what do I what do I need for canonical invariance? So I need something that's called Lie algebra. And people who know Lie algebra can go to sleep for 5 minutes. What I have to define Lie algebra, I have a set of operators, Ai, Aj, which their commutation relation is closed. I can write it like that. So this is called the structure tensor, and here Ak. And I have a set of operators that their commutation relations are closed. So a set of operators like that is called the Lie algebra, and they're generators of a Lie group. Now, what I claim that if the dynamics is like that, and is generated by this Hamiltonian, so you see our Hamiltonian is linear combination of operators inside my algebra, then what I claim is that the canonical form is, or generalized canonical form, is close to the dynamics. So this is, in a way, a theorem that I want to illustrate. So this is what we want to do. So I have, let's start again, I have an algebra, I have my equation of motion, I have a Hamiltonian that's constructed from members of the algebra, and I want to show that the equations of motion, or the Heisenberg equations of motion and the Schrödinger equation of motion, are closed. So The first proof of it is, let's look at the Heisenberg equation of motion. So the change in the operator A, which is in the algebra, is this commutator. We can write it HLAI, and we can write it like that. So it means that I get a set of coupled linear differential equations. These are just coefficients that relate I to the operators K, and a set of linear differential equations I can always solve. So what does it mean? If I think about Heisenberg equations of motion, if they are constructed, my Hamiltonian is constructed from a certain algebra, then this equation is closed. So as an example, we had our harmonic oscillator. You can say the algebra, just as an illustration, we could use the set of operators Q squared, P squared, and PQ plus QP. So the set of these three operators is closed to commutation relation. You take the commutator of this, you get this up to a factor of 2a. You work it up. And if you take this commutator with this, you get this, and so this is a closed linear algebra. The truth is that the harmonic oscillator, I can add two more variables. So all this set, six operators, sometimes it's called the Heisenberg-Weyl algebra, forms the Lie algebra. So this set is closed to commutators. And now my Hamiltonian is constructed from these two. So we have all the ingredients that we need for closed equation of motion, and this is what we used before. This is what I showed you before. So this is to generalize to any algebra that is closed. You get this expression. It doesn't matter if it's time dependent or time independent. It's time dependent, these coefficients will be time dependent, but still the same structure will get. Okay, so now we want to show that we can get canonical invariants. So our structure of the density operator is like that. It's a sum of our operators in the algebra. So now you can show that for a closed algebra, a power of a sum can always be written as a product. So this is a theorem by Norman and Way, which shows that this can always be written like that. But the order here, if you change order, you change these coefficients. So what does it mean? That there's a relation between the coefficients here, which are the Lagrange multipliers, and the coefficients here, which appear in this canonical form. So canonical form can either be written like that or written like that. If these operators commute, then it wouldn't be an algebra, then this is trivial. But these operators don't commute, so there's always a way to write it like that. Now, let's take this form. Here's my equation of motion for in the Schrödinger form, and write d dt of rho and multiply it by rho minus 1, the inverse of that. What's the inverse of this? It's inverse order, and everything here is a minus. So if we take the time derivative of this piece here, we see that we have functions of alpha, dot, and alpha, which appear from this time derivative here, times the operators ak, because this is a closed algebra. And to the right-hand side, because I multiplied this by this inverse, again, I get a linear combination of this algebra. And eventually what I get, that this is closed. So this equation, basically to solve this, I need the equations of motion for these coefficients, for these alpha. So I see that this is a closed set of, non-linear differential equations, which can in principle be solved because they fit the theorem of differential equations. So what I showed you, that if my dynamics is driven like that, or like that, and I have a closed algebra, I can write canonical invariants for a closed set of Lie algebra.
Excuse me, so this IQMP, all of them are closed in this example?
Where?
In the white points, you give the example of Hamming-Postulated.
Yeah.
IQMP, the subset.
So this, you could say I have a sub-algebra. This is closed, but I could add these two. So I have either a full algebra of six operators, which is called Heisenberg-Wild, but I can have a sub-algebra of three. Now, in our case of the engine, three is enough because you could say the expectation value of this and this are zero all the time.
So you don't say three like that.
Okay, I can work in my sub-algebra, so that in this. So canonical invariance is a strong thing because it tells you I can describe the state of the system by only, in our case, three variables. If I have a different algebra, if I have a spin algebra, sometimes you can do it with, again, SU2 algebra. Maybe I'll give an example of another engine. You could do the same because this structure would... Okay. So here's this example. Again, this is a whole set. Instead of Q, we wrote X. And here's what we have. This is, again, what I talked about before, our Hamiltonian. These are all linear combinations of the same algebra. So if the original set is closed, also HLC is closed, because all that I did a linear combination. So if I take a linear combination of my algebra and define new variables, I didn't do anything. It didn't change that. So that's why I can go and work with this minimum set HLC of operators and close my algebra. Now, in any Lie algebra, there is what's called this Casimir. In this specific case of the algebra, this Casimir looks like that. And what does this Casimir mean? This is an operator that commutes with all other operators in the algebra. It's not a member of the algebra, but it commutes with all of them. So what does it mean? That if my Hamiltonian is generated from this algebra, the Casimir is going to be a constant of motion. So automatically it reduces my complexity by one. I have a constant of motion. What I'm saying, this is only for the adiabatic branches, and we can define the coherence. You can say the square of these two operators. This tells us how much coherence we are generating. Now, for the harmonic oscillator, the generalized Gibbs state, it can be written like that. This is the squeeze state, as I said before. And here you have C as with respect to the raising and lowering operators. L is the sum of the squares. C is the, and the Hamiltonian, you can write it like that. And if you want to know what's the relation between expectation value and these parameters here, the squeezing parameter and beta, this effective temperature, here is the relation. And here you can get this effective temperature out of this equation. So if you know all these expectation values, you have explicit parameters. And here's, this is the squeezing parameter. As you say, it's related to L and C. This is tells how much squeezing you do. And since G is a constant of motion, and we said yesterday that adiabatic or unitary doesn't change the von Neumann entropy, so the von Neumann entropy has to be a function of the Casimir. So here it is. The von Neumann entropy is a function of the Casimir, so if we squeeze or things like that, the von Neumann entropy doesn't change. On the other hand, the energy entropy, which is always bigger than the von Neumann entropy, changes with the expectation value only of H. So the energy entropy is a function of H, has this form, and the von Neumann entropy is only a function of the Casimir. So these things kind of are satisfactory because it tells us, okay, if I have a constant, the entropy has to be in some way or another a function of the constant. Okay, this we talked about. Okay, now here comes something more delicate. Can we have canonical invariance for an open quantum system? Until now I told you that if we have a closed algebra, we have canonical invariance for Heisenberg equations of motion or Schrödinger, which the Hamiltonian is a linear combination of the algebra. But now we have these Lindblad terms. So let's assume that these Lindblad terms are also members of the algebra. So the question is, do I get canonical invariance here? So let's say here's my equation. So this is canonical invariance for open quantum systems. So the question is, can we do that? You already know the answer for the harmonic oscillator. The answer is yes. But in general, it's not so simple. Again, I can use the same trick. I can write my density operator as a product, and I can write it like that. The left-hand side, this is a linear combination of these terms. So this is okay. The Hamiltonian part, as we saw, this is Baker-Hausdorff, so this is also linear combination of the algebra. So our real issue is this close to our algebra? So we can say L d rho rho minus 1, is this expression here a linear combination of our algebra? And in general, this doesn't have to be. But for the case of the harmonic oscillator that we did, it works. And the reason is that you can see these F operators are combined from these two, from Q and P. So when we square them, because here we have them in both sides, so basically they're squared. So when we square them, we still reach the algebra. So, because of the structure of the harmonic oscillator, canonical invariance also works for the harmonic oscillator, but in general, I showed you before, we have closed Heisenberg equations of motion for these operators, but it also means that our density operator we can write in a canonical form, and this is the description that we used for the Otto cycle. You can see these are all canonical forms. You can see for harmonic oscillator, they're generalized Gaussians. In phase space, you're in position momentum. So here's a squeeze state. You see, this is an equilibrium state. So let's say I allocated a lot of time here, so I reached equilibrium for this bowl. Why is it the bowl? Because this is the energy in phase space. So in this direction it's q squared, in this direction it's p squared. So the energy shell looks like a bowl. So in the hot side I have high frequency, so the bowl is squeezed in this direction, and my state fits the bowl. This is the cold side, so if I move fast from here to here, this is again a squeezed state. If I equilibrate, you see the bowl becomes more shallow, wider. This is an equilibrium state for here, but this is a generalized canonical state. So we do the cycle either in this direction and in this direction by a set of a generalized Gibbs state. So in this case, of the harmonic oscillator, we can say, we have a good description. Every point in the cycle can be described by a generalized canonical state, means we have a description of the state, and it's sufficient to solve Heisenberg equations of motion, and from that extract everything. We can extract the entropy, we can extract all properties by basically solving three coupled equations. So in this case, they were analytic, but in general, if it's more complicated time dependent, I could do it numerically. It's not a difficult exercise to do. Okay, so let's build on this, and I want to give you some more example after. This is the conclusion when we can get closed, when we get closed Heisenberg equations of motion imply generalized canonical invariance. That's for unitary evolution. It's for open quantum system, it's a necessary but not sufficient condition to get that. And okay, this is, you can use this as an approximation. This. Maybe I'll leave it here. That's a nice image. Okay, so now, if there are questions about that, I want to describe another example of discrete engines.
Here I was a little bit confused with your definition of wild Heisenberg algebra. It's just a command. Wild Heisenberg algebra, as I know, is just ordinary position and momentum operators.
Just this piece.
Yes. And but the rest is, it's actually the algebra, q squared, p squared, dq plus dp. And it's, I think it's O2 algebra, or SO2 algebra, which can be turned into an SU2 by using the quadratures instead of...
No, it can't be. It can't be turned to SU2 because SU2 has a different cousin. So there's no way...
SU11, I'm sorry.
SU11.
Yes, this is pleasing.
Okay, so this is more a term of question of terminology. Okay, we can identify, this is a sub-algebra. We could call this the truth is in the literature, this is fuzzy. Your definitions of SU11 is better, right? Because this is mathematics. But in the literature, sometimes just this is called, and sometimes the whole, what's called the enveloping algebra. It's all the six members. So we can identify sub-algebra here, another sub-algebra here, but all of it is one bigger algebra. So it means that if we want to move our oscillator from one position to another, we can still do that and stay in a canonical. We could use the six operators instead of the three, and we still could be in business in the same, using the same ideas.
The cognition of H, L, and C is a physical function.
Yeah. So H, that's a time dependent. So you chose it because of the energy. You're interested in energy. So now the energy is time dependent, so you want that. So how would I choose in general? You always need the energy if you want the heat engine. But then you try to close an algebra. So you want to find, you can take H at different times and see which algebra it generates. So.
Actually, these are all linear canonical transformation generators. That's Q squared, P squared.
Okay, so. Let's give another example of another algebra. So let's say I can build my engine. So I can do it like that. I have two spins and some magnetic trap. This is a model of n spins in a magnetic trap that we have, which would have omega sigma z1 plus sigma z2. So the two spins are in the same magnetic trap. And so this part is my time dependent. So I'm changing my magnetic field, so this is where I'm going to get my workout. So this is a controllable part of the Hamiltonian, and I can add an uncontrollable part. I think this is right. So what's called XY coupling. I can choose something else, but the idea is that this is the spin-spin interaction. You can say this is members of dipole-dipole interaction. I can use add another one, sigma z if I want to do that. So this is kind of a general model of working fluid that's composed of magnetic material. I control the magnetic external magnetic field, but I have some internal magnetic coupling between my spins. So this is uncontrollable, and this is controllable. Now, we invented a certain model like that. Other people invented different models that look like that. But in a way, doesn't all of them are interesting in a way, but let's try it. You could reduce this model. This model, on purpose, if you think about it, how many operators I have here with two spins? I have 15 operators. For each spin, to describe spin, I need I sigma x sigma y sigma z. I have two spins, 16 operators. I have the identity, so I need 15 numbers to define my state. So it is a closed algebra. You can't get out of the spin. By definition, it's a trivial algebra of this case. But you could solve it like that with 15 equations of motion, but you want to make a more simple model. So this makes it a more simple model, which you can reduce it to an SU2. So you can write it like that. I'll write it SZ plus J. And these members form the angular momentum algebra. You can generate SU2 things from other things. Now, you can diagonalize this and you can get that omega is omega squared plus j squared. And if and this is altogether spin one, so I get three energy levels, degenerate, this is minus omega, this is plus omega, and here I get this is zero. So I get four levels, this is degenerate, and here this is my structure of the Hamiltonian if I diagonalize. So here I have, in a way, very similar structure to the harmonic oscillator. It's a closed Lie algebra. It's also closed for thermalization. And we could repeat this exercise that we did now. I won't repeat it again. But you can read it in my notes for this SU2 algebra. And I can build an engine out of this, this algebra in a similar way. And the main point here is the same, that the Hamiltonian at different times doesn't commute. Because Sx and Sz don't commute, this is time dependent, this is my sometimes called zero field splitting, this J, depends on which community you come from. So if I change my omega, this is true, and this model would be much closer to what's called adiabatic demagnetization refrigerator that's in outer space. The truth is I saw one in Vienna, in Schmidt-Meyer's laboratory, because helium became expensive and people are looking for alternatives to dilution refrigerators. So he had a box about this size. And from the outside, it had said ADR. Diabetic. Inside, this is hopefully this is what he had inside his refrigerator. So these things work. Now, the story that I told you for the harmonic oscillator, we can repeat it here. Again, we can ask how fast can we move to stay adiabatic. We can define for this algebra also adiabatic parameter. We can go at a constant adiabatic speed. It's also completely analytical, solvable, for mu is constant. Mu here is a little bit more complicated because you can see we're changing the direction of the equilibrium magnetization while we change omega. So, but and the conclusions that we drew before, that there is a trade-off between efficiency and power. This story repeats itself in this type of algebra. It's not the same because a Casimir is Sx squared. It's a Casimir of SU2. Just the total angular, the square of the total angular moment, square of the components. So the Casimir is a different Casimir, so it's a compact algebra. It doesn't have the properties that our harmonic oscillator has. But still, what I told you about generating coherence is the same here. I can use the same type of algebra of HLC, which I did for the harmonic oscillator. The definitions will be a little bit different. L is not the Lagrangian, it doesn't look like that. But I can build, okay, I have an algebra, now I'll build first H, and then I'll find the commutators of H and close the algebra that I need. And what doesn't commute with H is coherence by definition. So I can repeat this story.
Can we use it to define the generation cost of coherence?
Yeah, so the definition of coherence is the same, it's L squared plus C squared. The same, because in this case you could write the density.